Good day, everyone. This is the second part of our discussions involving consolidated statement of financial position at the date of acquisition. Make sure to watch the two parts of the previously released compilations involving how to compute goodwill or gain on acquisition if there is non-controlling interest, because that discussion or those discussions would really help us understand this part too well. All right, so let's go back to our source, the Book of Guerrero. And then this part here would be discussing about acquisition of partially owned subsidiary, which is less than 100% interest. So as said, NCI or non-controlling interest, formerly known as MI or minority interest, is that interest or percentage of the shares or shareholdings of a certain corporation that is acquired, in which such is that portion not acquired by the parent or the acquirer. So basically, if the parent or acquirer acquires 80%, of the shares of the subsidiary or acquiree, so the difference 100% minus 80%, 20% is a non-controlling interest. So to measure, that's already discussed in the two previously released videos, in which the priority at the top would be at fair value, and the second would be the NCI's proportionate share of the acquiree's identifiable net assets. As said, for number one, if it is absent, so we are going to make use of the estimated fair value. Then for the second one, it will be based on the percentage of the NCI of the fair value of identifiable net assets of the subsidiary or acquiree, which is also known as the partial goodwill approach or method. For number one, the estimated fair value is also known as the full goodwill approach or method. Take note that, as said, there are actually no requirements as set by IFRS 3, but it seems that with the two options, the first one is prioritized because it is at fair value though. So again, that's discussed already in the two previously released outputs. Then we have here now the P company statement of financial position at the date of acquisition, December 1, 2013. Assets, liabilities, and equity at book values. Because upon consolidation, only the book values of the parent's accounts will be combined with the subsidiary's fair values of assets and liabilities. Then the difference would be the net assets. Take note that the equity accounts of the subsidiary or acquiree will be canceled or will be removed upon consolidation. All right. Then for case four, this is the case where acquisition is more than the fair value with adjustment of subsidiary accounts. So this adjustment is the excess of fair value over book values. We have here the situation that B company, the parent, acquires 80% of S company. So to acquire, it issues 16,000 shares at 50 pesos fair value. So if we multiply the two, that would be 800,000. So this is a case of acquisition through issuance of shares. Although we can also acquire through other means like non-cash items or even cash items. Of course, that's the basic one. And then we can also issue bonds if we would like to. Nevertheless, the debit is investment in S company. The question will be on the credit. So shall we credit cash, the equity or bonds, liabilities, and so on. Then the 50,000 professional fees, which is a direct acquisition cost, shall be expensed immediately. So as said, whether the costs are direct or indirect, they shall be expensed immediately. For the second entry, you can notice that we debited the retained earnings fee company because we're only seeing the statement of financial position accounts, which are real accounts, meaning they're not closed. For acquisition expense, they may be using this one because the books of accounts are not yet closed. Although for number one, I have to mention that common stock or ordinary shares will be at par value, while the excess will be the additional paid in capital. Then 170,000 NCI, this is the given amount of the NCI. We have to make sure if this satisfies the minimum. So to compute goodwill under the standard procedure, this is the formula that we are going to follow. The price paid is the consideration, whatever that is. The NCI is at fair value. We have to make sure that this amount or value satisfies the minimum. The minimum is the percentage of NCI multiplied by the fair value of net assets acquired. So 20% of this amount is 124,000. So 124,000 is, of course, lower than this amount, meaning we use this one. This is the value that is given anyway. Now, what if it's not given or there is no given? Again, we are going to compute the fair value or estimate the fair value. So how do we do the estimation? Well, remember, we have the 800,000 price paid, which is at 80%. 800,000 divided by 0.80 is 1 million. Now, 1 million, of course, that's the total, that's 100%. If we multiply that with 20%, meaning the NCI as estimated is 200,000. And if we use that here, then the result is 380,000. Also, if we use the minimum option 2, 124,000 here, so the goodwill is 304,000. So this is based on the standard formula for computations. What if we are going to use the DNA of excess schedule in this particular item? So you just have to make the table, the particulars here, fair value, parent, and NCI. The parent would be, of course, the 80% values, NCI will be at 20%, and these are the fair value amounts. Now, if we deduct fair value of subsidiary with the book value, we get the excess of fair value over book value. So I was looking here at the book value, which is actually the percentage already share of parent and NCI over the interest acquired. So book value of interest acquired here, 320,000 multiplied by the percentages would equate to 256,000 and 64,000 respectively. So we have here also the excess. So 970,000 minus 320,000 equals 650,000, and these are the given amounts or values. Then should we deduct the fair value over the book value of the interest acquired? Again, we get the excess of FV over book value. And then if we deduct the adjustment of identifiable accounts, which are the excesses of the fair values over book values, then we will get the goodwill or gain on acquisition. We can notice the two values are the same. Now, at 350,000, of course. We can also realize that if we are going to just combine the total equity, which is the book value of interest acquired, and the adjustment of identifiable accounts, which are the excesses of fair values of these assets, actually, less the book values of them, then we do the opposite. This is negative, so we just have to add it here. You'll still get 620,000, which is actually the fair value of identifiable net assets acquired. So 970,000 minus 620,000 equals 350,000. All right, so these items are discussed already from the above. We can also make use of this particular DNA of excess schedule, most especially that this is favorable for elimination entries. So here are the working paper elimination entries then. So we have E1 and then E2. For E1, this is the elimination of the book values of the interest acquired. So we have here the equity interest of the subsidiary. Then 80% of such is for the investment and 20% is for the NCI. Right. Well, for E2, then we are going to place here or put here the asset accounts for the company. So we have them here. These are the excesses of fair value over book value. And then the remaining balance to close them will be credited to also the investment and the NCI. And again, we can see them here. from the excess or out of the excesses so that the accounts would be closed. And then the remaining would be now the goodwill. So if we are going to add actually this two, this would equate to 320. And if we are going to add this amount, that would equate to 650. Okay, so which is the excess here, right? So you can see that here. Okay, and 650 minus 350, of course, is the 300 excesses. For consolidation working paper, these particular notes will be mentioned anyway. So we have the heading, and we also have the heading here on the table. Particulars, P and S companies, respectively, parent and subsidiary. The eliminations and adjustments of both debit and credit and the consolidated values or amounts. Now, for the consolidation purposes, remember we are going to combine same or similar items. So for cash, we just simply have to add accounts receivable to accounts receivable, inventory to inventory, etc., and so on. Then we can notice here that what we have actually done in the elimination entries, they are to be placed under these columns, and we can see that they are numbered with numbers 1 and 2. So 1 is for the first elimination entry, 2 for the second elimination entry. Then we combine, we simplify, whether add or minus. So we can see here that the assets are reflected now to their fair values. Then P value, of course, basically or values is or are at the book value or values, whereas companies are at fair values. Then investment and S company is eliminated. Again, as said, under entity concept, there is but one economic entity to consider between or with the parent and subsidiary. So that's why we are doing the consolidation. So it is very awkward that we invest from our pocket to also our pocket. So it's the same or but the same company. And that's why we have to eliminate the investment account. Then another one is that we are going to eliminate also the equity accounts of the subsidiary. Then we recognize the NCI. For the NCI, non-controlling interest, this is really a separate line item in the statement of financial position under the shareholders equity section, in which the equity accounts of the non-controlling interest would be presented as one line item, but the details, of course, can be shown in the notes to financial statements, like how much really is its share of the common stock, additional paid in capital, and the retained earnings. So all components of the NCI will be placed on that account. So it will not be like separated also as three components of equity, such as the share capital, the accumulated profits and losses, and other comprehensive income. Then we get the total, and the two sides must be balanced. So what will remain? The assets combined, the liabilities combined, equity of the parent, then NCI. For the consolidated statement of financial position, we can see here the heading, the assets, current and non-current liabilities, and the shareholders' equity with emphasis on the non-controlling interest. Next, for adjustment of goodwill applicable to NCI, by this value analysis, this is now another table. So far, we had two a while ago. We have the standard formula to compute goodwill. Second is the DNA of excess schedule, and this one is the value analysis schedule. So this would show also the goodwill. But what is good here is that it will be shown, or we can really see here as to what value of goodwill that composes or that belongs to the parent and to the NCI respectively. So we have here the company fair value at cost. Then we have the NCI, which is given by this problem or the problem a while ago, case 4, we get the total company fair value. Then the fair value of net assets, we have to exclude goodwill because that is an unidentifiable intangible asset. So double un, so A-N-U-N, an unidentifiable intangible asset. All right, so 620,000, then we multiplied such with 80%. So we get the goodwill 250,000, which is the same a while ago in the two methods. And we will realize that out of this one, 204,000 belongs to the parent and 46,000 belongs to the NCI. You just have to take note that the NCI share of goodwill could be reduced to zero. Here, zero. But the NCI fair value of net assets cannot be reduced to zero in terms of, again, the NCI. So that's why we said that we can, or we must always look for the minimum should we determine the value of the NCI. This 124,000, again, is computed as the fair value of identifiable net assets at 620,000 times 20%. So this means 124,000 is the minimum value. So we have here, for example, 124,000, let's just say, under proportionate share of identifiable net assets of subsidiary. Or, for example, if we are not given, let's say, the value of the NCI, then we have to estimate, and still it is lower than this amount. So we have to use 124,000, and this can be zero. So if this is zero, of course, all goodwill will be attributable to the parent, right? So this is what I've said here a while ago. The 24,000 belongs to the parent. Okay, next, what if case 5, acquisition at less than fair value with adjustment of subsidiary accounts? It will be the same in terms of the process, but what I like in this problem is that there is a gain on acquisition, not goodwill. So let's check. We have 8,000 at 50 pesos, the same fair value. So we have 400,000 cost of investment. Then professional fees, the same, shall be expensed immediately or charged to retained earnings since the books of accounts have already been closed. So to check, we have to make sure that our estimated NCI, because it's not given, should be satisfying the minimum. So 400,000 divided by 80% is 500,000 times 20% is 100,000. 100,000, our estimated fair value is lower than the minimum NCI. That is the reason that we have to use the minimum or switch to partial goodwill or the fair value of proportionate share of identifiable net assets of the subsidiary. So we have here the 400,000 plus the 124,000 equals 524,000. Less here, so we get gain and acquisition of 96,000 pesos. So in that case, for the gain, it shall only be applied or charged to the parent in this situation because we are using the minimum. So the moment that we use the minimum, everything goes to the parent. And if, for example, we actually had higher than the minimum, so it's really possible that a portion will go to the NCI. So this is the method, which is value analysis, right? This is the standard formula, and this is the DNA of Excel schedule. If we are going to compute goodwill, I would suggest to use this one. The standard, this is easy. But if it is really a requirement in the problem to use value analysis schedule or DNA, because this is like the requirement should we do a consolidation. Because again, this would really help us in the elimination. So same steps, the format, and then this is at 80% each. The excess would be different though, because the fair value now is lowered down to 524,000. Then the excess would also change here. Adjustments are the same. So we can also combine these two again to equate to 620,000. to be easier and to be parallel with this formula. And 524,000 minus 620,000 equals negative 96,000, which is really a gain on acquisition. To do the elimination, so E1 will be to eliminate the equity accounts at book values, then to recognize the excess of fair value over book value, and we are going to close, of course, further the investment account and the NCI and recognize the gain on acquisition, which is really close directly to the parent, so we don't have to make use of the gain on acquisition on the sense that at the date of acquisition, only the statement of financial position is to be prepared. So that explains, even if the books of accounts are still open, but then this is like, of course, closing, I would say. So if we use, for example, the gain on acquisition later on, you also have to close it to retain earnings. So nevertheless, the process will be the same. Then, or the overall impact will be the same. Consolidation is the same. So combine similar items, headings, of course, prior. Recognize for the first one, the elimination of the equity accounts. And here for the share of investment and the NCI for book value of interest acquired of the subsidiary. Then restatement of book values of the subsidiary to equate to fair values. And then we also have to close the investment account for such equivalent amount or the balance as well as the NCI. So we will be getting, of course, the values here as simplified for consolidated. Retained earnings also should be highlighted for the gain on acquisition, which is added to the parent's account. All right. Then techniques in the calculation and allocation of goodwill and or gain on acquisition. So in this case, what we can do, we will have to follow, of course, the steps that we have known in the value of analysis schedule, but we will just be reserving this for the next installment or part. So hopefully you have learned something from this session. Thank you very much, and God bless us all.